Hello my dear friends, welcome back to the channel and this is your friend Dr. Suresh Shenvi. Before going ahead, I hope and pray that all of you are doing great in the current situation of COVID-19, and I'm requesting everyone to follow the guidelines given by World Health Organization and your respective government. Today we are discussing a very important topic, that is dental amalgam, which is asked very commonly in most of the entrance exams including United States, India and Middle East. Before you understand any other restorative material, it is important that you understand dental amalgam, because that allows you to compare various properties of those materials. Amalgam also has ADS specification number 1. Although the use of dental amalgam is greatly reduced, but many of the developing countries still rely on dental amalgam as restorative material. Coming to the meaning of dental amalgam, basically dental amalgam means it is a mixture of two or more metals, but one of the metal has to be mercury. So mercury is very essential in dental amalgam, and that's why we discuss so much on the mercury and why it is harmful to the environment, why the dental amalgam has to be discontinued. But you have to really ask this question, that why was the mercury chosen in the dental amalgam and why not any other metal? The answer is very simple, that mercury is only one of those few metals that is liquid at room temperature. You have gallium, but that has not been very successful. But mercury is truly liquid at room temperature, and this allows incorporation of few other metals with it, and that gives you a moldable mix, and the reaction continues and then it sets and it gives you a restoration. Now when we discuss about the composition of the other metals which you intend to mix with mercury, we tend to hear only few metals, and those are generally silver, copper, tin and zinc and probably. Now why is that? That is because mercury cannot react with all of the other metals. It has a better reacting property with the silver, aluminium, gold, copper, zinc, tin, but it cannot react with iron. We all know that mercury is really bad. But when I ask the students, why is the world discontinuing dental amalgam as a restorative material? They tend to tell me that it is harmful to the patient. Now that's really controversial, because most of the textbooks what I have read clearly says that probably dental amalgam is not harmful to the patient, because the amount of mercury what gets released from the restoration may be very less compared to what mercury is already there, what we inhale from the environment. Of course, that is controversial and there are a few countries which are banning it. But the question is, why are they banning dental amalgam? Is it because it is harmful to the patient, or is it because of some other reason? The main reason for banning the dental amalgam as restorative material is not because it is harmful to the patient. It is because many of the dentists may discard this waste into the drain, or if you give it to the municipality, it is difficult to process the dental amalgam and extract the mercury from it, because if this gets leaked into the environment, it runs into the food chain, and stopping that is very difficult. So the management of the dental amalgam waste is very difficult, and that is why the world is trying to stop the use of dental amalgam restoration. So you may ask me that if the mercury is not so bad to the human health, then why are you saying that in initial mix we should reduce the mercury as much as possible? You may have heard about Ames technique. The teacher has always told you to condense it as much as possible so that the final amount of mercury is less into the restoration. That is because if you have more mercury left into the restoration, that forms a phase called as mercury phase. So you may have the reaction products here and there, but there might be some areas where a free mercury is remaining, but this doesn't have any other reactive products and even the original silver tin alloy. So this is the weakest phase which is present into the dental amalgam restoration. I know many of the students think that gamma 2 phase is the weakest phase, but if you read a textbook called as Marzu, it is the mercury phase which is called as the most weakest phase. And in one of the exams, the questions did ask both the options, that is mercury phase and gamma 2 phase. And we hear so much about gamma 2 phase and that is the weakest. Most of the students marked gamma 2 phase, but the real answer is mercury phase. So when you have this question, please look whether you have mercury phase as the option. So if you have more mercury phase, the strength is less, there is more corrosion, because mercury tends to reduce the ability of any other metal to resist the corrosion. Now let us understand more about the dental amalgam alloy, that is the powder which has to be mixed with the mercury. The ADAS specification number 1 and the GV black composition both clearly said that the maximum amount of the dental amalgam alloy should be silver and tin. Silver is around 70 to 76, 77% and then remaining would be tin, and then you can add various other metals depending on which generation of amalgam alloy you are using. So silver is very important because it gives strength to the restoration. Now you may ask me, why not have just silver and mercury and let us eliminate all the other metals? If you incorporate a lot of silver without any other metal with mercury, then they have found that the restoration expands over a period of time. So to reduce this, tin was added. Now we all discussed so much about negativity of tin, that it forms a gamma 2 phase that is harmful. But it is only the tin which reduces the expansion of the dental amalgam. Rest all metals are going to increase the expansion of the dental amalgam restoration. So, but the problem with the tin is that it is more susceptible to corrosion when it reacts with the mercury, and it also has less strength. So overall, the strength of the restoration would reduce. And that's why the tin is limited to probably 20 to 25% and the amount of silver is more. So now that you have understood why mercury, silver and tin is used in the amalgam, let us now understand the setting reaction between these components. The original phase, that is the silver and tin, which remains into the reaction when the amalgam alloy and the mercury reacts, that is called as gamma phase. And the gamma phase is the strongest phase out of all the phases which have been mentioned into the textbook. Now at this point you have to remember that although the gamma phase is the strongest one, but if they are not held together, then you cannot take the benefit of the strength of the gamma phase, that is the silver tin phase. And this is done by a phase called as gamma 1 phase, that is the phase which is formed when the silver reacts with the mercury. So the gamma 1 phase holds the gamma phase together so that the amalgam can attain good amount of strength. Another important point about gamma 1 phase is it is stronger than the gamma 2 phase, which will be formed because of tin, but it is less stronger than the gamma phase, which is formed because of the original composition, that is silver and tin, without reacting with the mercury. The second phase, as mentioned, is the gamma 2 phase, which is formed because of tin reacting with the mercury. Unfortunately, this phase is not good for the amalgam because this has less resistance to corrosion and it has less strength compared to all the other phases. But the most weakest phase is still the mercury phase, and then the second weakest phase is the gamma 2 phase. Gamma 2 phase just has 10% of strength what gamma phase can attain. Now to overcome the disadvantage of gamma 2 phase, the copper was added. Earlier the copper was definitely present into the dental amalgam alloy, but the percentage was very less. Now if you want to eliminate the gamma 2 phase, then the amount of copper which is added should be more. The textbook does say that if you have a copper more than 12%, then the gamma 2 phase can be eliminated. Now please remember, the gamma 2 phase is weaker not because of the tin, but it is the reaction of tin with the mercury which makes it more susceptible to the corrosion. So if you can prevent the reaction of tin with the mercury, you can definitely eliminate the formation of gamma 2. Now that is done with the copper. Since copper has more affinity with the tin will react with the copper and not with the mercury, and hence making a phase called as eta or epsilon, and the gamma 2 phase is no longer formed. So the amalgams are now called as high copper amalgam. So the high copper amalgam has better strength, better resistant to corrosion, and nowadays all the practitioners only use high copper amalgam alloys for the amalgam restoration. It is also found that by incorporating copper, you can actually make finer particles of the amalgam alloy, because without copper, the silver appears to be really brittle. Now, another important component is the zinc into the dental amalgam alloy. The mix containing zincs are better to handle, and the zinc also acts as a deoxidizer. But the zinc can cause something called as delayed expansion, which we'll discuss in future. So it's the quiz time. The question is, who invented the high copper amalgam? If you know the answer, please do mention in the comment section. Also, please feel free to write your comments and suggestions so that I can improve my next video for the dental amalgam. I hope to see you soon on my channel, and please don't forget to subscribe. Thank you so much. Have a great day.